everyone, it's Aggie. Welcome back to my channel. Today I'm filming my GCSE tips video, which is very, very long awaited. So thank you all for waiting. This video is quite long. It takes quite a while to film, so thank you for your patience. And if you want to skip ahead to any parts, just feel free to do that. For those of you that don't know me, I am currently an engineering student at university. But like the rest of you watching, well, most of you watching, I did GCSEs and I finished them in 2014. For my GCSEs, I did 10 subjects. My school had compulsory subjects, which were English, English literature, mathematics, biology, chemistry, and physics. And then on top of that, you could do 3 or 4. I did history, Spanish, music, and art. For me, GCSEs were really enjoyable because I didn't have to worry about university or future careers or anything like that. If you are taking your GCSEs this year, enjoy the curriculum and good luck for your exams. Okay, so now I'm going to tell you my results. If you don't want to hear about my results, then skip ahead to the next part. Promise I'm not bragging, but this was requested by a few subscribers, so I'm going to talk about my results. Okay, so I've got all my certificates here. For English, I got 91%, which is an A star. For Englit, I got 94%, which is also an A star. For Math, I did Edexcel. I got 97 out of 100, which is an A star. For biology, chemistry, and physics, I did the Edexcel double award. For biology, I got 155 out of 180, which is a weird ratio, and it's 86%, which is an A star. Chemistry, I got 170 out of 180, which is 94% A star. For physics, I got 166 out of 180, which translates to 92% A star. And then for my other subjects that weren't compulsory in my school that I did history, Edexcel, which I got 95 out of 100 A star. I did Spanish, I got 91 A star, and I did music, and I got 97% A star, and then finally art and design, 93% A star. Okay, so those were my results, and I remember at the end of year 11, in the summer before year 12, I was really nervous about GCSE results, but you should remember that they aren't what determines your future, and it essentially doesn't matter what you get. I say this with caution because you should definitely work hard and you should definitely try and learn as much as you can, but don't cry or like kill yourself if you get, you know, not what you expected or what you wanted. But in saying that, I am quite happy with my GCSE results. Looking back, I wish I'd studied harder for biology because it's the only subject I didn't get 90% in, but really it doesn't matter. I think for me, GCSE was a time for exploring, definitely not a time to settle on, you know, my future career, because you're only 14 or 15. And it's a time to, you know, try everything, and then if you don't like it, then you won't make such a big mistake, if you get what I mean. I think it's good to get a range, try and get some science subjects, humanities, languages, arts, try and get a mix of everything. I would say the only subject you must do is math. Coming from an engineering student, that's probably a bit biased, but I think math is one of those things that you can't live without, because GCSE level really is the minimum that you need out there in the world. And I cannot stress the importance of knowing at least GCSE level math. I think this, well, largely depends on your timetable and your school schedule and how teaching is held out. Maybe you really want to do two subjects, but they're timetabled to be at the same time, so you can't do both. But hopefully you'll be able to schedule everything that you want to do. I'd say aim to do at least 8, but if you are interested, then take more. But I wouldn't recommend doing more than 13, because at some point you have to stop taking exams and start living your life. 13 really is the maximum, because school isn't just about academic work. It is a large part of school life, but I think you should also do other types of things, like, you know, ECAs, like sports, music, to kind of have a balance. If you just do, you know, you could do like 16 GCSEs for all who cared, but you'd just be a study machine. So I think 8 to 13 is a good number of GCSEs to do. Double. Yeah. You know, like, most people who do single are actually able to do double, because the double award is just a slight extension of the single award. Like, there's not much more stuff to it. It's just a little bit more, and you just need to push yourself a tiny bit more. So I'd recommend doing the double award, because it's recognized more than the single award. Ideally, yes, because there are performance sections in your course, and it would be useful to know how to play something so you don't have to pick it up from scratch. And for the theory parts, a knowledge of grade 3 theory, around grade 3 theory, would be useful too. No, but don't think art is kind of an easy subject. It's kind of the most time-consuming subject there is at GCSE level. It focuses more on your development of material than your skill, but be prepared to spend lots and lots of time on your art projects. Preferably, you should have a basic knowledge of the language, as in, don't be a complete beginner when you take the GCSE. I would recommend taking a language that isn't one of your mother tongues, because universities sometimes look at that and they don't accept it as a GCSE. So that's just one thing about languages. I'd say go for something general, like history or geography, because those are useful in your daily life, and it kind of links to everything, and it's useful and interesting. So history, geography, those are good picks. For English, we didn't use any textbooks, the teacher just taught us. And for English literature, it depends on what text you are studying. For us, we had I'm the King of Castle by Susan Hill, which was a very dark kind of read. And I really enjoyed this part of the course, because I really like the novel. And we did Shakespeare, The Tempest, here with all my markings. And so this is just the text. And then we also had a booklet of poems. For mathematics, I have given my book away, but it was a thick blue book that I almost never opened, because for mathematics, it's not really necessary. The teacher just taught us, and then we did practice questions. For the sciences, we used the generic Edexcel textbooks. This is the chemistry one, you know, generic science textbook. This is the physics one. I didn't use the physics one much, because my teacher had notes that were better than the textbook. And then for biology, the textbook I used a lot, because they had all the diagrams that I needed and all the text. And basically, biology is kind of a memorization subject. You just need to know everything in the book and you'll be fine. So these three, Edexcel, P Pearson published textbooks. For history, it depends what topics you're doing. For us, we did Russia, so we had this big book called Modern World History for GCSE, and then inside there was one section on what we were doing. This bit with communism and Lenin, Trotsky stuff. And then we also did USA, and this is the textbook for the USA module. It's by Hodder Education, and again, history is kind of memorization. You still have to apply knowledge in the form of writing essays, but as long as you know everything in the book, you should be fine. So we did freedom, civil rights, fear of communism, women's rights, that kind of stuff. So all in this book. Then for history, you also did medicine and health through time, and we used this textbook looking at diseases in the 18th century and public health and stuff like that. And I have to admit, I didn't really like this textbook because it was a bit too colourful and they had a bit too much going on a page. So I would recommend writing your own notes from the textbook, which I'll talk about later. For Spanish, we used this textbook from Pearson. I really liked this one because at the end of every chapter there was a list of palabras, which is vocabulary, and it had the translation as well and all the phrases and stuff that were useful. So I used this for my compositions and my speakings and all that kind of stuff. It split itself into very neat little chapters that we did in class, so that was quite useful. For art, obviously there's no textbook. You just do your own research in books and on the internet, mostly the internet nowadays, and by, you know, looking in museums and stuff like that. For music, we didn't use a textbook for most of it. Our teacher just taught us and we wrote notes in like notebooks. But we had for world music this, which will be familiar to all kinds of music students, I think, because it has everything about world music in it. So this was just for the world music section. In terms of other resources, there are lots available on the internet and in sort of alternate textbooks. But I think the most useful thing for me was BBC Bite Size. I'll put the link down below. I'm pretty sure you will have come across it already. It is literally bite size, so it condenses information into sort of small digestible chunks of text and diagrams, and it kind of helped me understand. But don't rely completely on revision material that is made by companies, because they don't contain the same amount of detail. So I'd say always refer to your textbook or the notes that your teacher gives you to get the full story. One thing I really need to get out, and I know some of you will completely disagree, is I hate the CGP revision guides, you know, those thin booklets that you get. Very colourful and all that. Yes, it looks pretty, but I think it was utterly useless. The information contained was near to none. The text was just in a really bad kind of marker font. The colours were confusing and they underlined random words just like randomly, and the pictures were meant to be funny, but I just didn't find them funny because they were sad almost. If you're taking my advice, I'd say don't buy any of the CGP revision guides because they are a ripoff. You are much better off writing your own notes or using the ones that your teacher gave you. In a normal term, so like a non-exam time term, I did about an hour of homework for every subject except for arts, which I spent about 2 hours on every week at home. But even if you don't get homework, So if your teacher doesn't give you homework, I'd say you should still spend an hour on it every week. So before bed, I would read the science textbooks or the history textbooks, because I find that the easiest way to learn is reading before bed. When you're sleeping, the knowledge that you absorb throughout the day gets kind of consolidated in your brain, so it's very useful to just read before bed to refresh it or something. I think firstly you really need to pick something that you want to do. If you want to do that subject, it's no longer boring, it's no longer work, it's just fun. However, say your school forced you to take something you completely didn't like and you really needed to find motivation to finish the GCSE at least, I would say remind yourself that every bit of knowledge you learn is useful and will make you a more all-rounded, successful person. And even though it sounds boring, and it is boring, you should still try your best because it might come in handy. Yeah. Okay, so part three is my tips on coursework. Not all subjects have coursework, so I'm going to talk about the subjects I took that had coursework. For English writing, you had to, you know, write different pieces. Some were kind of logical, argumentative pieces, and some were kind of fictional, creative writing pieces. So, as with everything creative, it has to come from somewhere. So, read more, I'd say. Read all kinds of books, fiction, newspapers. I'd say classics are quite important, you know, like classic novels. In particular, I liked Frankenstein and Pride and Prejudice, but you might have other things that you like. And for the argumentative pieces, use words such as, you know, furthermore or on the other hand, to make everything clearer and more logical, flowy, if you get what I mean. The most important thing in English literature is to know your material, because if you don't know it, then you don't have anything to say about it. So whether it's analysing poetry or a Shakespeare play or anything, writing about stuff is easier if you know what you're talking about. For me, I copied down important quotes while I was reading the text, so you don't have to, you know, flip back to it and say, okay, where was that important quote that I knew was there but isn't there anymore? So I actually made a Word document, and on one hand I read the book, and then when I saw, you know, important quote, I typed it into the Word document, so later when I wrote my essays or essay outlines, I could refer to the quote list and just pick out what I needed. I think it doesn't really matter what you do in terms of pieces, but at the end you should definitely lay it all out in a kind of readable, logical format. So I had to produce 8 A2 pages, I think. Yeah, and have a kind of clear journey throughout your portfolio, even if you don't know what you're doing, because the examiner has to read it and people have to see, you know, what went on behind the whole thing, and write mini notes to kind of explain everything. I'll put a link down below to a blog post my teacher wrote about my art project for GCSE. My topic was stories, treasures and memories, and I looked at like paper cranes and, you know, kind of daily objects that related to me. So I'll put a link down below so you can see what my art project was like. Big tip for art, big tip is to start early. You don't want to be rushing art. Paint takes time to dry is what I'm going to say. Definitely try to be finished with your portfolio before April in the school year, because it has to get submitted and stuff. You know, before the Easter holidays, you should have everything kind of finished and polished, and just leave the final tweaking bits to afterwards. And also you don't want to be, you know, worrying about your portfolio when you have to be studying for your written exams for other subjects. So just get it out of the way and be done with it, and you will be a much happier GCSE student. Prior to study leave, you should have already learned everything. You shouldn't be learning stuff during revision time, because that's not the point. My techniques might work for you, but they might not. These are just the ways I got through my GCSEs, and it worked fine, I should say. For English, do all the past papers available, take a highlighter, and you can highlight the question paper, that's fine, but don't highlight your answers, because you're not allowed that in the exam. But highlight the question paper to, you know, pick out important bits of the question or important bits in the text that you have to answer questions about, and I found that quite helpful. For English literature, write essay outlines, because, you know, in your exam you'll be writing essays. So I had this kind of notebook, and I wrote just kind of the shell of an essay. So don't write the actual essay, but just write the shell. So main points I labeled, you know, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And then underneath I wrote, you know, kind of what I wanted to say about it. And then the main kind of quote that I'm going to use to support my point. I found that to be the best way to get through as many topics as possible, because you don't want to walk into an English literature exam being faced with a foreign idea. You want to already know what you are going to write. You can't really predict the question that they're going to ask in an English literature exam unless you cheat, which is unacceptable. But you should definitely have an idea, you know, if the question were this, I am going to write this. And if the question were that, I'm going to write that. So you should have kind of a brief outline in your mind, so you're not surprised and you won't panic in your exam. So per bit of set text, I did about 20 essay outlines. Out of those, just pick your favorite and time yourself in writing an essay. But it really doesn't matter about, you know, the final essay. It's more of the shell. If you have the shell, then you can just expand it when you write. For math, pretty simple, do past papers. Math is just one of those things where you have to practice and practice, and then it goes ting, and then you get it. That's it. For sciences, I wrote lots of notes. This is my ultra amazing GCSE notebook. So I started off with chemistry. I'll just flick through and let you have a look. So I drew like diagrams, that kind of stuff. I cut out tables from, you know, printouts and the rest of them. I drew my own electronic structure shells, pH scales and all that stuff. Drew my own crude oil refinery stuff, alkenes, cracking. Definitely practice how to draw, you know, what are these called? The stick things with the C and the H's, because that's important. On this page, I had to remember some equations and conditions. So I wrote the equations and the conditions, such as catalyst or temperature, in another color, so it was easier to remember. And then on to biology. Biology was much more colorful, because that helps me remember stuff. And there was also more like memorization in biology. I drew like the cells, that kind of stuff, enzymes. I cut out pictures of hearts and lungs and stuff and glued them in. Label your diagrams, definitely. Oh, this topic really killed it, because I was so scared. I just spent like hours and hours just looking at this page, and at the end I just could memorize everything about the AI. And diagrams, and oh my gosh, this is like the greatest creation ever. I drew a picture of what's this thing called? Loop of Henle? Nephrons in the kidney, yeah. and you know, like leaves, I drew this myself. Yes, I did. And just, I think with biology, using a lot of colors helps. And definitely label your stuff, you know, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, like that, very clear, so you know what you're talking about. Chemistry and biology were kind of more memorization, but physics I didn't write much notes for because I felt that I could just understand it. Same case with A-levels, I just thought physics, you know, there's no point writing notes because it's already in there. For history, I also wrote notes. I started off writing, handwriting my notes like biology and chemistry. So, just letting you see all the pages and notes. Different colors, definitely. And then I kind of ran out of paper and also got bored, so I started typing my notes. If you would like a copy of my notes, I already told you the topics that I was doing. So if you'd like a copy of my typed notes, then just email me, I can send them to you. Typing, I would say, is less effective than handwriting notes because when you're handwriting stuff, it goes through your brain. But when you're typing, you can almost just, you know, not know what you're doing and just type. So I think handwriting notes is definitely a better option, but typing notes, it's easier to, you know, send it to friends or like exchange it or change stuff without having to go through the pain of correction tape. It's all a matter of preference, and for you, you might like type notes better because they're neater, but my handwriting was neat enough anyway, so I didn't type a lot of notes except for history. For history, also make timelines. Put everything in chronological order for that topic, so then you know what you're talking about, and in the exam it'll be easier to remember, you know, dates and facts and stuff like that. For languages such as Spanish, I'd say practice speaking with a friend. The more you immerse yourself in the language, the easier it will come to you. Some things you can do is change the language of your phone, which sounds pretty scary, but I did it. My phone is in Spanish, and I find it very useful because you're looking at your phone every day and you're just looking at Spanish words, and that makes it easier for you to say them or to use them because you've been using them every day. For music, listen to more examples on YouTube. If you are struggling with classical music, then look at Bach, Beethoven, Liszt, you know, just that kind of stuff, and just listen to more of the examples on YouTube so you are more familiar with it. For world music especially, because there will be some genres of music from, you know, parts of the world you have never been to or never experienced, and it's all quite new, so definitely listen to more stuff on YouTube. For the practical sections of music, there's just one thing you can do, is practice until it's perfect. You should get it perfect before your recording date, so then you can just walk in and have like a perfect recording and you don't have to redo it. As you know, art is split into two sections. There's like a coursework section and then there's a final piece part. So have a plan ready. You should have the general sort of composition of your art piece sought out already. Try and make a list, write it down or something, which task takes how long, you know, like, okay, maybe putting the ground down will take this long, drawing the outline will take this long, doing shadows will take this long, doing the highlights will take this long, or like final touches, or if you're like sticking stuff, it will take, you know, 1 hour or something. You should only allow minor changes at the exam, because you don't want to be walking in and having major changes and then having it all messed up because you decided to change something. So you should have it all thought out, and then at the end you can change stuff, you know, while you're painting, but don't change a lot of stuff, if that makes sense. Part 5 is about exams, which is definitely what everyone stresses about the most, unfortunately. If you're taking GCSEs, this is likely the first time you have something called study leave, which is when you don't have lessons and you just have time to revise. Definitely make a timetable, because you can look at, you know, all the free hours that you have and go like, okay, I'll just take a holiday. Definitely do not go on holiday. Make a timetable, don't waste your time, you know, schedule everything. So I'm gonna do a paper and then I'm going to eat lunch and then I'm gonna take a break for, you know, piano practice. And then I'm going to do another paper and then I'm going to write an essay outline and then I'm gonna eat dinner, you know, that kind of stuff. During study leave, you should definitely get enough sleep because often there'll be, you know, two exams in a day, and if the day before you don't sleep well, then you mess up your two exams on the next day. So you definitely want to go to bed at least at 11 every day. Be prepared. Obviously, academically be prepared. So know everything on the syllabus. Also be prepared in terms of, you know, your mental preparedness. Walk in with all your necessary stationery. You're not allowed to bring pencil cases in, so my pencil case right now would not be allowed in. You have to have a clear pencil case, but you know who goes and buys clear pencil cases. So I just got a bag from IKEA. You can see the inside. You can see the inside of everything. So I just put my pens and stuff in my my calculator. Calculators without the lid, so you don't have to, you know, go into the exam room, get discovered with the lid and come back out. So without the lid, okay. And you know, pencils, erasers, put them all in the bag so you can just go to an exam with your bag and not have to go like, okay, where's my eraser, where's my thing, okay. Water bottles have to be clear as well, so have to be kind of see-through. For me, I had to drink water once in a while just to calm myself down because the whole, you know, process of just made myself feel calmer. So I brought in a clear water bottle with water inside. Once you know you are in your exam desk, just focus on the exam and just do it. Just tell yourself it'll be over in 2 or 3 hours and just do it. Yeah. I think if you are prepared for exams, you will feel less stressed. After an exam, you know, relax, just take a hot shower. Try not to think about what happened in the exam because that'll just wind you up. Because remember, you have exams after the exam you just took. So if you keep thinking about the exam that you just took, then you're not spending as much time as you can preparing for the exams that will come next. So, you know, spend 10 minutes crying, throw a plate at the wall if you have to, but after that, just calm down and think about your next exam. Okay, so that was all my Q&A questions answered, hopefully. Now, for some general advice, enjoy your GCSEs. I think year 11 was kind of the best part of my school life because it was a year where I didn't have to worry about university or focus too much on academic work. Definitely don't just study, do stuff in school. Sports, music, they're all outlets for you to, you know, express yourself and discover who you are. Definitely study hard, but also do other stuff. Make friends, they are a very important part of your life. Some of the friends I've made in GCSE were friends till now. We still talking though we study at different universities. If you have further questions about GCSEs, feel free to email me. I can promise that I'll answer right away because university is quite busy this time of year. But yeah, feel free to email me if you want any help or if you want the history notes that I mentioned earlier. I also have an A-level tips video for those of you that are moving on from GCSE this year. So feel free to watch that, maybe you'll find that helpful. I'll put all useful links down below. Thanks for watching and I'll see you in my next video. Bye!